My father was the Reverend John Kirkwood of Edinburgh, a man well known for the rigor of his life and the tenor of his Pope administrations. I might have blessed Providence for this honorable origin had not I been forced to deplore the harshness of my nature. I have no children of my own, or none that I saw fit to educate, yet it appears my father may have been too strict. In the matter of pocket money, he gave me a pittance, and when upon one occasion I took the liberty to protest, he brought me up short with this home thrust of inquiry.
Should I give you more, Jamie? Will you promise me it shall be spent as I would wish?
I did not answer quickly, but truthfully.
No.
I went from the room before he had answered in any form of speech, and I went, I must acknowledge, in despair. I was then 22 years of age, a medical student at the university, already somewhat involved with debt, and already more or less used to costly dissipations, and I had exactly 4 shillings. In a billiard room in St. Andrew Street, I shortly quadrupled the amount at a game of pyramids. The billiard room was next door to a betting agency, so there I went and staked all upon the hazard of a race. At about 5 in the afternoon of the next day, I was the possessor of some £30, 6 times as much as I had ever dreamed of spending. I was not a bad young man, although a little loose. I may have been merry and lazy. Until that cursed night, I had never known what it was to be overpowered with drink, so it is possible that I was overpowered the more completely. I have never been clearly aware of where I went or what I did or how long a time elapsed to my awakening. Everything I saw delighted me, and all at once the light of my reason went out. The thread of memory was broken. I came to myself in bed. I had certainly slept for some while, for I was sober. I had certainly undressed, for I lay in linen. It was not yet day, for through half-closed eyelids, I was aware of the light of a gas jet. Something tore about my waist. I looked down and saw, instead of my nightshirt, a woman's chemise. It was not my nightshirt. It was not my room, and yet by its shape and the position of the window, it exactly corresponded with mine. In some drunken aberration, I had mistaken the door, stumbled into the wrong house, to the wrong room, and gone to sleep in the bed of some young lady. I hurried into my clothes, quaking, then opened the door.
¿Qué demonios está usted haciendo ahí?
I beg your pardon. Madam, for the love of God, make no mistake. I'm no thief, and I give you my word. I'm a gentleman. I've been violently drunk, and that's my poetic confession. It seems that your house is built like mine, and that my key unlocked your front door. Also, our bedrooms are in the same possessions. How or why I came here, the Lord knows, but I wakened in your bed a few minutes back, and here I am. It is ruin for me if I'm found. If you can help me out, you'll save a fellow from a dreadful mess. But if you can't, or won't, then God help me.
I have never seen you before. You're none of Manton's friends.
Manton? I've never even heard of Manton. I tell you, I don't know where I am. I thought I was in Queen Street, number 14, the Reverend Dr. Kirkwood's house. That's my father.
You're streets away from that. This is Manton Jameson. You're not fooling me.
No. Look, I tore your nightshirt.
La verdad es que tienes un aspecto muy gracioso con eso. What? This is not like a thief. But how did you get into such a state?
Well, the great affair is not to get into such a state again.
We must get you smuggled out. Can you use the window?
Not this window. It'll have to be the door.
The trouble is that Manton's friends, they play roulette and sometimes they play late. And the sooner you are gone, the better. Manton must not see you.
For God's sake, not. I am very lucky that you are prepared to help such an unwelcome guest.
I am not thinking of you in the least.
At this point, Robert Louis Stevenson stopped writing the story of A Recluse, which is not the book you saw at the start behind the title, but just four pages in this collection of his unfinished stories. The only clues we have as to how Stevenson would have continued the tale are in the part you've just seen filmed. Scottish BBC employed me to give their film an ending, and the filmmakers think that you'll enjoy it more if I tell you how I worked it out. So first, the setting. Edinburgh, in the 1880s, and the world-famous Fourth Railway Bridge is nearing completion. Victorian Edinburgh was a center of scientific thought and commercial initiative. Stevenson's grandfather, for instance, designed and built the world's first modern lighthouses. It was also the most stuffily respectable of European capitals, but had a dark underside. And in this city stand two houses with exactly the same appearance and internal architecture. One belongs to a highly respected clergyman, and the other men drink and gamble into the wee small hours. And in each house, a high-spirited youngster lives with an older man they are inclined to dread. Jamie has his father, the Reverend John Kirkwood. The girl has Manton Jameson. Who is he? Let's look at Victorian Edinburgh again. It is not a huge city. The prosperous families are mostly long established and know each other well, at least by name. Yet Jamie, a rakish medical student in the final years, has not heard of someone who in that city would have generated the most intense gossip. A seemingly prosperous man whose home is a gambling den. So Manton Jameson is a newcomer. So we have the setting and the characters. What about the plot? Well, that has reached the boy meets girl stage. Sam Goldwyn wanted all his films to have just one plot. Boy meets girl, boy loses girl, boy gets girl. Half the world's most cheery stories of that plot, whether they're films or fairy tales or Shakespeare comedies. Did Stevenson intend his hero to get this particular girl? Well, one thing we can be sure, he meant Jamie to fall in love with her, so our drama had better bring them closer together.
We must get you smuggled out. Can you use the window?
Not this window. It'll have to be the door.
The trouble is that Manton's friends, they play roulette and sometimes they play late. And the sooner you are gone, the better. Manton must not see you.
For God's sake, not. I am very lucky that you are prepared to help such an unwelcome guest.
I am not thinking of you in the least. I am thinking of myself.
Juliet?
Yes?
May I enter?
Claro, prevent you, Manton. Pero la verdad es que estoy muy cansada para tener compañía esta noche.
Who are you talking to? My boy, you've just made the biggest mistake of your life.
No, Manton, no es lo que te imaginas. Déjame que te lo explique.
Sorry, that won't do. We're going too fast. Yes, Jamie and Manton must fight for the girl, but I want the result to depend on more than a violent punch-up. I want you, the viewer, to get to know them a bit better and perhaps come to like them. So we'll go back to where they start talking like friends, and we'll allow them time to develop, and I won't interrupt again for a very long while.
am not thinking of you in the least. I am thinking of myself. The company downstairs is deadly dull. Deadly, deadly dull. But I am capricious. I have discovered that I cannot rest without another hour of their slurred voices and smoky breaths. I will return to them. To be as fascinating as usual. Maybe. More so. Follow me down quietly at a safe distance. And wait on the landing when I enter the drawing room. I will ensure that nobody leaves it for a while. You must do the rest for yourself.
Yes, but please, give me your name. I must tell you that
I... You must tell me nothing. Do exactly what I have told you. And be careful. For both our sakes.
And now Jimmy can start to fall in love. His delight at escaping is replaced by astonishment at his close dealings with a beautiful, brave, mysterious woman. He has worn her nightgown, slept in her bed, seen her in a privacy only allowed to lovers or husbands. She has talked to him as an equal, conspired with him as a friend, and saved him from social ruin. He gets home, admits himself, and is astonished at how familiar the place seems. Outside his bedroom, he hesitates, fearing and hoping that when he opens the door, he will see once more the girl's bedroom. However, this is not a story of the supernatural. It is his own bedroom and his own bed. For the second time that night, he prepares himself for sleep.
Not hear you come home last night.
No, sir.
I assume it was not your medical studies which kept you out of the house till well past 2 in the morning.
Well, this is not like a thief. But how did you get into such a state?
Jamie, I have said these words to you before, but I will not say them again. So attend. Attend! You are not working properly at the studies which ought one day to get you a living. Man is born to earn his bread by the sweat of his brow. I am a minister of religion. I am required to set an example in this community. I must not support a son who is a mere idler, wastrel, and profligate.
I have never seen you before. You're none of Manton's friends.
I will give the matter thought, sir.
Sir, when the current enters the nerve, the muscle contracts beast is headless. What may we conclude? What, Mr. Kirkwood? May we conclude?
I am not thinking of you in the least. I am thinking of myself.
Okay, cut! Cut it, forget it, that's too much damn smoke! Cut it!
Yeah? Hmm?
Does that mean you don't like it?
Well, when I was directing Flight of the Hearn, we had seen it.
Of course, I asked for Edinburgh University Quadrangle. But
the man in the white hat is the director, the other one is the producer. When things go wrong, scenes like these are very common.
What have you got, love? You've got Edinburgh.
Not where I asked. Well, I'll kill that. I'll talk to you later. Polly, give me that, quick!
Go on.
Run! Come on, run all the way for God's sake. Get out of my head.
What I'm worried about, what I'm concerned about, how does Jamie and the girl get themselves back together again?
Gemmell will introduce them. He's in my script. Gemmell.
Gemmell? But he's not in Stevenson's book, though.
He's not, but if Stevenson had finished the story, he'd have mentioned somebody like
Gemmell.
Yeah, well, I know. We could have Jamie and Gemmell against a backdrop of old Edinburgh, just like it is with a squalor and a pain and a piss pots and
a
prostitutes.
A little less smoke.
That's all right, but please just don't mix my words up. Film is basically a writer's art.
Oh, no, we won't.
Alasdair, I'm the extras of the smoke and the rain machines. I don't want to unleash writer's ego.
Thank you, listen, dear.
Okay, everybody.
Just don't.
I was at Bond yesterday and you'll already have two tomorrow. Let's take a bit of talk. Two are here. Come on. Get in. Move it. Come on, let's have some action around here. Let's kick ass. Get in. Come on. Action.
Aren't you going to Manson's, please?
Not tonight. I'm out of funds.
Don't worry, I'll send you it, you love.
Hello, Kirkwood. How's your head today?
Who is Manson Jameson?
You should know. You were in his house last night.
Why do you think so?
We took you there, you duffer. You were pretty tight, though.
We all were, rather.
Yes, you certainly did us proud last night, Kirkwood.
What exactly did I do, Gamble?
Nothing that I know. The servant let us into the hall, and we looked round, you'd absconded. You don't remember?
It's just as well. You missed seeing Juliet, a lovely Miss Juliet O'Sullivan.
A woman to die for, Kirkwood.
Is she Irish?
I suppose her father was, but the blood of the conquistadors flows in her veins.
Tell me about Manton Jameson.
He runs the only gentlemanly shebeen in Edinburgh. It's so gentlemanly nobody calls it a shebeen. But if you're the right sort, you can drink and play there till all hours. Manton made his pile in America, so they say. Nobody knows how. I certainly wouldn't like to ask him.
Who's Mrs. Sullivan?
Juliet! Juliet adds tone to the establishment. She's beautiful, Kirkwood. She's witty, and she sings like an angel. We swarm about her like bees round a queen. Manton never lets her out of his sight. No wonder. She's his ward, his niece, his stepdaughter, or something else. I'm in love with her, Kirkwood, but that's nothing unusual.
I'd like to go there sober, Charlie, tonight if possible. Can you introduce me?
Nothing easier. You're a sort Manton would take to. The deuce of it is, I'm clean out of funds. And though gambling isn't compulsory at Manton's place, it's the done thing. We'll be given all the champagne we want, so it's only fair that one hazard something on a game. Are you penniless again?
Yes.
Well, you certainly did us proud last night. But I suppose you have a watch. Yes, this is a good watch. We can raise quite a bit in it. Shall I show you where?
Good evening, Farlin. This gentleman is a particular friend of mine.
I assume Mr. Jameson will have no objection to me introducing him into the company.
I'm sure not, sir. I'm sure not. Time to answer. Bank of deals. Either player may place the cutting card. These cards 1 or 11. These cards 10. Other cards at the pit value.
Good evening,
Mr. Jameson. I took the liberty of bringing a friend, Jamie Kirkwood, who greatly wishes to meet you. His father is.
Oh, we know who his reverend father is.
Watch your manners, gentlemen. I've heard of you, Mr. Kirkwood. You are welcome. As you can see, we are still at play, so if you'll excuse us if we continue, perhaps you will join us later on. My game, sir. Oh, your hostess is my ward, Miss O'Sullivan. Julia. Right, would you pass me his money? Thank you. That is very welcome.
How nice to see you again, Mr. German. And so soon.
Can't keep away from you, Miss O'Sullivan.
What do you do? As hostess, I should introduce you to the other guests, Mr.
Kirkwood.
But most of them, as you see, are engaged with the game. There is the buffet. Please help me.
Confess it. You're smitten.
Love me.
I've never seen her so chilly with a new guest before, but don't take it to heart. Pursue her. Pursue her. She flirts with all of us eventually. Nothing comes of it.
So, this urn, yes, this quite big urn full of fetid stuff comes crashing down upon his head, and well, it was no joke, I can tell you. However, not all professors are such duffers. Oh, hello, Kirkwood.
Harry, do you see Mr. Kirkwood is queuing up for me?
It looks like it. I'm just going to sit tight, however.
Oh, be kind. Give him just a minute.
Well, yes. Why ever not? Kirkwood, Miss O'Sullivan.
You have no right to be here.
I have as much right as Charlie Gamble.
You are no gambler.
I am whatever I choose to be.
Do you choose to be rich? Are you rich? Did I not prove last night I was your friend? I am still your friend. Leave this house and don't come back. Don't miss you again, ever. Please.
Excuse me.
Don't miss you again, ever.
I will!
Both hands.
Card.
I like it.
Card.
Well.
The bank has done very well tonight, Dalglish. Mm-hmm. Take my place for a bit, will you? I need to stretch. Oh. Do you like card play?
Why else would I come?
Oh, yes, of course. Do you know, in this tight little Presbyterian Republic of Scotland, card play has all the intoxications of forbidden fruit. Yeah, some of my guests play because the company makes them feel like devilish fine fellows.
I will play when I can afford it.
Would you like a loan?
No.
Good. And I see that, like myself, you do not drink.
Oh.
I have hopes for you. Yeah. Get your friend out of here. He's completely out of his mind.
You must go now.
Back.
Next time.
Well, I shan't be back there in a hurry.
It's nearly a month to my next allowance. My brute of a governor won't allow me another advance. And all money everywhere. Everywhere. You were wise to drag me away when you did. I usually hang on to the bitter end because of Juliet. The beautiful Miss Juliet O'Sullivan. Wasn't I right, Kirkwood? Isn't she a woman to die for?
Hey.
Good evening. Good evening, me dumb.
Here's the pawn ticket. And here's the change. Not much, I'm afraid. I had hoped to repay you with interest, Kirkwood. But luck was against me.
Luck does not exist. Luck is superstitious rot. You lost to Manton like everybody else tonight because he is skillful, and you're all idiots.
Could you have done better?
Of course not. I did not play. But when I go back there, Charlie, when we go back there, we will play and we will win because we will have made ourselves better than Manton.
How?
By study and practice, by practice and study. There are books and card games, are there not? Books by dependable authorities?
Well, Cavendish is thought pretty good. And one or two French fellows. Je t'aime! Je t'aime! Je t'aime! But I can't afford you, madam.
Might just
you're
be
too
enough.
Expensive.
We apply ourselves hard. After all, there's nothing better to do.
I'll go away with you.
Farewell! Farewell! Remember me!
I have a favor to ask. I believe I will do better at my studies if I share them with a college friend, Charlie Gemmell. Since this house is a quieter place than his, I want us to work most evenings and weekends in the privacy of my bedroom. Would you object to him sharing our meals between the whiles?
I can have no possible objection to that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
plus one.
Yes.
It doesn't count. Plus one.
Mm-hmm.
Minus one.
What are you doing with your chain? A thought's just occurred to me. I wonder if you could calculate the odds on the chain. Could you? Try.
Try it.
Yeah. Go.
Minus one.
Yes.
Plus one.
Yeah.
Plus one.
Yes.
Doesn't count.
No.
Plus one.
Yes.
Minus one. Minus one.
Yes.
Food. I said food.
I'm beginning to understand this game, Charlie.
You and I would be qualified doctors if we'd given our medical studies this degree of attention. You're a monomaniac, Kirkwood. A fanatic, like your father. But cards have become your religion. I thought I was mad about them, but you've almost cured me. I must admit, though, your father keeps a good cook. Why don't you eat?
Chances always favor the bank. Manton's superior skill maintains his lead in a game which is already on his side.
Banks have been broken.
Yes, by runs of luck. But we could wait weeks or months before hitting one of those, and we don't have the resources to play a waiting game. Our strategy must make us rich in an evening. A single evening.
Only one strategy is sure to do that in a game which is 3/5 chance.
Yes.
I'm no saint, Kirkwood. I'm not going to preach to you. But foul play is impossible if you're not the banker. And even...
Hello, Father.
May I have a few words with you, Jimmy? Private words.
Shall I come to your study when I've finished my meal?
Do that. Your pocket money.
8 guineas.
I'm giving you more, Jimmy, because you deserve more. A month ago, you asked for an allowance worthy of a gentleman's son while declaring you would not spend it as a gentleman would. I admired your honesty, of course, but I loathed your cynicism. Since then, you have changed, Jimmy. When I look at you, I no longer see an ordinary, thankless young drifter. I see a man with a purpose, a man determined to make his way in life, a man I can trust.
Thank you, Father. You know, other gentlemen pay their sons pocket money not a month, but a quarter in advance.
Do they indeed?
Indeed they do.
And of course, I must do likewise. £24.
You're very kind to me.
Since you have changed for the better, Jimmy, it has occurred to me that perhaps I should make a similar effort. Perhaps one day, you and I may even be friends.
Perhaps. However, I must return to my studies. See this? My allowance. 24 guineas, the quarter in advance.
You are in luck.
No luck. I earned this gold. I earned about my devotion to that. But isn't it enough, Charlie? We need capital. Capital, courage, and a clear head. A man can do anything. And I know a certain desk.
Jamie,
it doesn't matter how we raise the capital, Charlie. We'll be able to return it the next day.
You can't be sure of that. For God's sake, don't do anything criminal. Listen, if you must borrow, I can give you the name of a moneylender. An out-and-out shark who will supply you with any amount of ready money. He'll know your governor's a respectable clergyman who'll pay a fortune to keep his son out of public scandal.
and he knows more than I know.
How much would you invest in our venture, Gamble?
Not a penny. When I get my allowance, I will pay my creditors, live frugally on the remainder, and never enter Manton's house again.
I've sown my wild oats.
The crop isn't worth a damn. As a man about town, I'm a failure, Jamie. You've taught me that. With a bit of effort, however, I can become a decent general practitioner.
So you won't choose to be rich? All the more for me.
Grant the answer.
Banker deals. Any player may place the cutting cards. Ace equals 111. Face cards 10.
Mr. Kirkwood, sir.
Ah, Mr. Kirkwood, we haven't had the pleasure of your company in a long time. Have you come for the card play or another tete-a-tete with your hostess?
For both, I hope. But first and foremost, the card play.
Excellent! Make room for Jamie Kirkwood.
By all means.
Well, you do play well, Mr. Kirkwood. You really play very well, Mr. Kirkwood. You've lost more than you've won, but that's the table's fault, not yours.
I wish, Mr. Jamieson, I had your chances of winning.
Everybody at this table has equal chances.
Not quite. The banker has a better chance than anyone.
The house risks the most amount of money, Mr. Kirkwood. It seems only fair that its losses, with reasonable care, should not bankrupt it. But if you wish to take my place as banker for a while, please do. There's more than £800 in the bank. You can cover that, of course.
It is £800 in notes and 200 guineas.
Jesus!
Quiet!
My ward, Miss O'Sullivan, seems to think you a foolish young man who should be asked to leave this house for his own good. But so far you haven't played like a fool. You're a cool customer, certainly, but you don't seem out of your mind. Your request is unusual, to be sure, but I've a mind to grant it. Take your place, Jamie Kirkwood. Juliet! Juliet, you'll stand here and watch the course of play. Excuse my harsh tones, gentlemen, but I admit to one superstition. My ward, Miss O'Sullivan, brings me luck. Well, I suppose I should not keep all my luck to myself. So, stand midway between me and Mr. Kirkwood, and that way we will both have luck. Huh. Luck. I can play no more with you tonight.
Congratulations. Congratulations.
It is a good thing for you, Mr. Kirkwood, that I'm an honest man. It is not convenient for me to pay all that I owe you here and now, but take the money on the table and I will make good the promissory notes within the year.
I have no objection to that. If I may be allowed to see more of you in the interval and Miss O'Sullivan here.
Juliet? What is your sentiment on the matter?
This is my sentiment, Manton.
It would be nice to end the story like that, but Robert Louis Stevenson won't let us. He called this the story of a recluse, the story of a man who cuts himself off from humanity, but not completely off. He told us at the very beginning,
I have no children of my own, or none that I saw fit to educate.
This must mean that in later life, Jamie only makes love to women he rents for money, or can quickly abandon. The plot of this story, therefore, is boy meets girl, boy tries very hard to get girl. Boy loses girl completely in ways that sicken him of humanity forever. If you like sweet endings, you can stop watching because I've given you one. We'll now go back just a little and go on to something more bitter.
Mr. Kirkwood, I will play no more with you tonight. You know the reason why, of course.
Why?
You're a foolish young man. If you will leave my house this instant, I will say no more about it. And keep your hands away from that money.
Do you accuse me of...
Cheating.
Yes, cheating.
You're the type that a professional like me can spot a mile away.
I did not cheat. The money is mine. I need it. Juliet, Mr. Sullivan, I did not cheat. You did not see me cheat.
Then show the company the contents of your pocket. No, the left-hand pocket.
I warned you not to come here. I must agree with my husband. I saw Mr. Kirkwood cheat.
Husband?
Yes, dear boy. We're man and wife. You see, in this godforsaken country, where fools like you from educated families, you find kept women much more attractive, don't they, my dear? So you see, she is my bait. Don't touch my money.
Eche este hombre fuera de mi casa.
Throw this cheat out.
I did not cheat. I'm not cheating, Juliet. Help, you're my friend. I'm looking for you, Juliet. I'll take you off to court. I'll have the Lord, you're willing. I'll tell my father. My father, the Reverend Dr. Cameron.
No, you can't. No, 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 no.
Bank the answer. Bank the deals.
Yes, well, I think I prefer the happy ending. Do you really want Jamie to die in a madhouse?
No, not die.
That hospital is money on the screen. It's got horrific visual impact.
He's just never ever happy again.
But why does Jamie have to become the recluse? Why not
Mantles,
of course.
I've told you why. At the very start, Stevenson makes Jamie say he never has children he bothers to educate.
But you haven't stuck to Stevenson's beginning. Stevenson has the girl say Manton played roulette with his friends.
Yes, Stevenson did.
And you changed it to cards because you said cards were more dramatic.
I changed it to cards because it is very difficult to cheat at roulette, and I needed Jimmy to be suspected of cheating.
So there are loads of possibilities. Let's go back and start again.
But keep the sets. Sets look fine.
If you really want a new beginning, the story will have to take a completely different direction. But all right, you're paying me.
Yes.
There are loads of possibilities. Let's go back and start again.
We must get you smuggled out.
I am very lucky that you're prepared to help such an unwelcome guest.
I am not thinking of you in the least. I am thinking of myself. And Manton.
Is Manton?
Pray God you never discover.
Penniless.
But I know where money is. Lots of it.
Is it all right to kill the star actor at the very beginning?
It's terrific! It has never been done before!
Yes, well, if I'd known that before we started, I'd never have cast Stewart Granger.
What I didn't like was that look of manic glee in Jamie's face when the girl told him she knew where the money was. It was totally out of character.
But don't you see? Jamie's character has been transformed by his fight with Manton. He's killed a man and finds he likes it. Dr. Jekyll becomes Mr. Hyde.
Don't you try to lecture me and Robert Louis Stevenson.
Well, I'm sure that we can deal with all that in the post-production. Our main problem is, what does Jamie do right now?
He can do anything we want him to do. He has the money. He has the girl. He's a completely free man.